It's an odd feeling to go inside the Krigel Windmill Factory in Nebraska City. A giant belt-driven wheel shaft powers machinery that dates back to the Civil War. Tools are left on the work table. An overcoat still hangs in the office. The only sign that the shop has been closed for more than two decades is the coating of dust on everything. And there is everything to be found in this factory.
Even in the office, the jotted down pencil notes are still on the desk. It truly is as if the owners walked out the door and never came back.
T. Lindsay Baker is a windmill expert and a consultant for a nonprofit group hoping to turn this once thriving factory into a world-class museum.
The thing that makes the Krigel factory important is that it is the only preserved original historic windmill factory that remains in the country.
What we need to do is get this bandsaw to go about a foot further.
Another consultant is John Bowditch, a specialist in turn-of-the-century industrial machines.
This is an amazing collection of machinery in here. That's one of the things that's special about the place.
Nebraska City industrialist George Krigel began the business in 1879. He moved the factory to this simple, prairie-style wood frame building on the main street of Nebraska City in 1903. His son Art eventually took over the family business. The Krigel factory made each windmill one at a time, an estimated 2,000 during a 50-year period for regional customers. A few remain in operation today, like the windmill at the Silcox family farm just across the border in Iowa.
And I'm going to prime it now. It's sat all winter, and this is the first time we've had it running this year, so I'm going to fill this up. I remember as a kid, you could stand here and probably see 10 of these windmills just in this area. This windmill dates back, I think, late 20s. Our farm acquired it in 69. It was lying in a ditch, and we restored it. It's been a great functioning windmill ever since. We've had to do just very minor maintenance to it. And we have people stop all the time and look at it and take pictures of it quite often.
Organizers hope there will be a strong interest from the public in how the windmills were made at this small factory.
It's kind of a time capsule. The sheer volume of stuff in here in 1994 is almost incomprehensible.
You know, they just used this little drift and this hammer and pounded the heck out of
these two experts first came to this factory 17 years ago.
It still seems cluttered, but you could imagine there was probably twice as much stuff in here at that time. These were string savers. The thing that struck me as much as anything else was the personalities of the people, particularly Art Krigel, towards the end of his life, come through in a kind of a very moving way in terms of the things that were important to them. And it's kind of a life capsule of them as much as it is anything else. That's what's unique.
What's also unusual is that the Krigel family saved records from the founding of the company in the 1870s until the end of business 112 years later, when Art Krigel died. It's one of the oldest continuous sets of business records in Nebraska history.
There is a bit of the feeling that anything that came in here stayed here. And so part of the challenge was to try to determine when things came in. We're trying to interpret the building as being around 1939 when they ceased windmill production in this space.
The Krigels switched from making windmills to repairing them when World War II led to a rationing of materials.
If the bandsaw is here, we may crowd things. I think this machine sticks way the heck out. We can always put it together and see, you know, what it looks like.
So during a long couple of days, these two experts are playing detective and trying to put this puzzle back together the way the factory would have been back in its heyday.
Yeah, everything is sagged up here.
The building has settled, and the main shaft is out of alignment by more than an inch. Even the electricity poses a mystery. The wiring is old, and the fuses are tricky.
I'm just going to do this momentarily. Well, that was a serious underwhelming. Oh, there we are.
Yeah, do it one more time. I thought I had one fluctuation here. All
right. It's always fun to watch something come to life that hasn't run for a long time and to know that you have the skills to be able to make something like this run. The thing about machinery is that motion is the soul of the machine. And if the public can see it run, they get a far better understanding of what it is and what its point was than if it's just sitting there.
Everything still works, but these machines have been replaced long ago by computerized modern systems.
Part of the problem is that industrial history tends to get thrown away. The person dies and they bring in an auctioneer and he sells off the machinery, and the good stuff goes to other shops and the bad stuff gets scrapped. So what's important about it is you have an entire labor system and an entire way of life preserved here that relates to what this town was and in a sense is all about, that has survived largely intact with very little having happened to it. That's rare.
For John Bowditch, one of the most important tasks in putting together this museum is preserving the apparent disorder.
There essentially is no other place in the world like this. I mean, it is an absolutely unique spot. Because it's very easy to throw away the wrong piece of dirt, frankly. Dirt tells us a great deal about, for example, the types of chips that were under a particular machine. You really want that there because that gives you that sense of Mr. Kriegel having just walked out the door and shut the door.